everyone. Good evening. I am Purnima from Fertility Coast, and today we have Dr. Vidya V. Bhatt with us. And with her, we are going to talk about technology and IVF. Dr. Vidya is from Radha Krishna IVF Center. She is medical director over there. And with her knowledge, with her experience, today she'll guide us towards the technology and IVF, like how technology is helping us to have more success rate in IVF or IUI cases. So good evening, ma'am, and welcome to our forum, Fertility Dost.
Good evening. Thank you so much. Thanks.
So, ma'am, today we'll be discussing the important pointers about technology. Like, for the past few years, we are seeing the success rate is on the increasing side. So, what we can contribute towards it, like what technology can contribute towards this success rate, today we'll discuss. Like, we have a lot many new tests with us right now, because earlier it was like laparoscopy or hysteroscopy, but today we are listening many new terms in this. One of this is laser hatching, ERA test, and yes, recently we have seen many talks about embryo glue also. So one by one, I would like you to please guide us through this term technology and IVF. So please.
Yeah. See, of course, when we talk about in vitro fertilization, we have a lot of issues here. It is not only the embryo, but the womb also. So it's a dialogue between the womb and the passenger or the embryo. So to get very good success rates, we do all sorts of things, and whatever the gap between this implantation, that is between the endometrium and the embryo, that has to narrow, in the sense that whatever problems are there in between, whatever is coming in between. So when we work up an infertile couple, we always start from the basics. And when everything appears normal, then, okay, they have not conceived, we think of IVF. Now the question comes, when there is repeated implantation failure, all the technologies which you spoke about comes when there is repeated implantation failure. And when there is repeated implantation failure, it is frustration to the patients and to the doctors. So what do we do next? So that's when we start thinking about the ERA, the laser hatching, and then we also think about the DNA fragmentation, and then of course the embryo glue or PRP. Then we think about the stem cell therapy. So all these things we start thinking about, saying that, okay, at least let one of these things help. So this question comes when there is no other reason. See, you said hysteroscopy, laparoscopy and all these things. When we find a obvious pathology or there is something endometrium, so when we don't find anything, but the woman is not conceiving, then we see it, look at the embryo. What can we do with the embryo? So what do we do? Do we have a good quality embryo? Is it a fragmented embryo? And to get a good quality embryo, what do we do? So that's when the test of DNA fragmentation comes. That is, if the husband's DNA fragmentation is high, then maybe we start thinking about how to bring it down. And then treat him, and also if necessary we do a TISA, so that when the sperms go through the tubules, there can be damage. So we do TISA, and then we try to improve the quality of the embryo. So now husband side, yes, we do this DNA fragmentation, but if the egg looks normal, but when you make it into an embryo, it doesn't improve in quality, then that is when we think about the laser hatching. You know, we use laser for hatching, which now has become quite common, because when there is a thick donor, or when we are unable to get a good quality embryo, in such cases we do laser hatching. this laser etching helps us to get a good quality embryo and also better implanted better implantation rates. Then of course, if we have to do a PGD, we know there is repeated implantation failure, or whatever embryos we transfer, that pregnancy test comes positive but the woman loses the pregnancy, or she has previous history of recurrent implantation failure. In such cases, we do the laser hatching, and also we do the use the laser to take the cell, that is PGD, PGT, and all these tests now which are done to know the quality of the embryo, and then we go ahead and transfer the embryo. Now the next issue comes with the endometrium. Now we have to look at the endometrium as a bed inside for a common man. It is a bed wherein this embryo gets implanted and we get a successful pregnancy. But if this passenger does not sit into the passage properly, that is, if the passage is not adequate or it is not adequately prepared, then of course we have to see what defects are there. That's when where your PG, ERA comes into the picture. So ERA is knowing the implantation window, that is when the progesterone levels is one, at the level of one, that is we start monitoring from day 8, and then when it reaches the progesterone level in the mid cycle one, the number one, and then we take a endometrial biopsy and send it for the ERA test, and that time we know the window of receptibility, whether it is 24 hours or 36 hours, and that's when we do the transfer. It may not be always that we get good results with this, but some cases we have achieved pregnancy in recurrent implantation failure. But ERA every time will not fetch us a good pregnancy. That is something which we have observed. Then of course, as we said, that how the passage is. Now in cases of this thin endometrium or the receptivity is not good, in such cases we give PRP. That is, we take the woman's blood and then we process it, and that's when we do the PRP, that is the platelet-rich plasma. So we do this preparation and inject inside the uterine cavity on day 8 and then day 12 or just 48 hours before the embryo transfer. So once we do this, we do have better pregnancy rates because this has improved the chances of implantation. So that is one thing we do. Then the last and final thing, which we everybody is now like talking about so much on stem cell. The stem cell therapy inside the uterine cavity, when the endometrium is very thin, or there is recurrent implantation failure, or there is previous history of Asherman's, and then we do not have a good endometrium because most of the endometrium is damaged because of fibrosis. In such cases, we do a hysteroscopic injection of stem cells on the day 5 and day 8 and day 12. So we take the stem cells from the iliac bone, process it, and then we inject inside the woman's uterine cavity. And this also has given positive pregnancy rates. Of course, the pregnancy rate is good, but the ongoing pregnancy rate may not be very good. See, when we talk about in vitro fertilization, it is just not pregnancy positive. When people say that our pregnancy rate is 60%, 70%, it is just not that, because we have to talk about the take-home baby rate. The take-home baby rate is about 30 to 35% only when we see anywhere in the world. Look at the results. Sometimes it is 28%. Sometimes it is 35%. Very rarely you get up to 40%, because we are going against nature here, and sometimes the complications in the mother may not allow us to look after the pregnancy till term. They may land up with abortions or IUD in between, depending upon the mother's maternal conditions, we do land up with these problems. So every time we talk about the success rate, I always tell them, because mine is a center wherein we do IVF and we look after the pregnancy for 9 months and we deliver them. So please talk about the take-home baby rate. It is not just, I have got 60% success, I have got 80% success. No, it is the take-home baby rate. It's just because the beta HCG is positive, we should not be concluding that our results are extremely good. It is how many mothers of IVF take home the baby and it is a uneventful pregnancy for them and it's a healthy baby they take. So that is very important when we talk about these IVF pregnancies. So that's when all these advances, recent advances, yes, has definitely made us to give better success rate. Even embryoscope, of course, people do embryoscopy. And embryoscopy, though it is expensive, it helps us to monitor the healthy embryo. It will give us the pictures of the embryo, healthy embryo dividing, and the time duration taken for the embryo to divide and achieve a healthy status, that is for the transfer, tells us that this is the embryo which is going to probably become a successful pregnancy. So embryoscopy also, there are certain centers which vouch by it, but all the centers don't do it. But that is another recent advancement which is there. But that doesn't mean that we'll get very good results. But those are one of the recent advances which we have seen. Then, of course, in male infertility, there are so many things of the magnetic cell sorting and PICSI and all those things, wherein the physiologically healthy sperm is taken and injected. And then the magnetic device sorts out different healthy embryo, healthy sperms, and then those are taken for ICSI. So all these recent advances, yes, gives us the better pregnancy rates, but does not mean it gives us a carry home better carry home pregnancy. But still, it is worthwhile trying out all this when the woman does not conceive, or if there is recurrent implantation failure, or if she has had previous failed pregnancies elsewhere, or if she is in the age group of 35 to 40 years and we want her to conceive with her own eggs, than changing the gamete. You know, when nothing happens, we go for oocyte donation and embryo donation and all that. So before that, it would be worthwhile trying all these newer technologies for our patients with infertility.
So ma'am, you just told us about this stem cell therapy. So yes. Could you please explain it more, like cost factor and when you suggest this particular therapy for your patients?
The cost, of course, is really going to be expensive because it's not only the stem cell, retrieving the stem cells, then the processing, and then once again injection, it'll just double up in lakhs, you know. So that's okay. It depends. It depends on each patient. So how much injections they need. But definitely, I would want this in women with a thin endometrium. Whenever we want a good pregnancy, we want the endometrial thickness to be at least above 7 to 8 millimeters within 1 centimeter, but at least 7 to 8 millimeters when we want to start progesterones. So if it is below that, we do in our center, we do something called priming. That is, we give the estrogen preparation, we prepare the endometrium 1 or 2 cycles before, and we call it as a mock cycle. And then in that particular cycle, we transfer the embryos. When we decide, okay, this cycle we have got a good endometrium, so the very next cycle we prepare her and we transfer. But in spite of this, if we do not get a good endometrial thickness, or if there is previous history of tuberculosis, and when we do hysteroscopy, there is scanty endometrium, or if I have done a hysteroscopy and release additions for Escherman's, in such cases, we do stem cell therapy. And the pregnancy rate is definitely better, but not very promising take-home pregnancy rate.
And thank you so much, Dr. Vidya. बहुत सारी चीजें नहीं थी. I don't know about the viewers, but yes, I enjoyed this session because magnetic thing was amazingly new for me. And yes, stem cell therapy. जैसे आपने बोला, it may be a costlier affair, but yes, कहीं ना कहीं वो हमें hope दे जाएगी. So thank you so much, Dr. Vidya. Thank you so much for joining us for this session. And viewers, once again, if you want any kind of consultation or you want to visit Dr. Vidya's center, please let us know, message us, and we'll arrange for the same. So thank you, ma'am. Thank you so
much. Thank you so much. Thanks. It was great talking to you, Purnima. You are so knowledgeable. You have so much of knowledge on this. So it really enjoyed talking to you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.